Good evening, everyone. We have several people coming in from the waiting room, so we're going to give them all a moment to join and to add their audio.
It's a lot of people.
Yeah.
Yes. Good response. See? Thanks for your patience as it continues to load.
Makes me think of that line from The Walrus and the Carpenter, and still they came, and on and on and more.
And on and on and on.
Well.
And still adding, so thanks as we, again, continue to load folks and allow them to add their audio. Still they come. You didn't know you were going to get a little singing this evening also. Ta-da!
Okay. All right, you're a diplomat in residence, Yvonne, like Jason, right?
We both are. Jason stuck with me, you see. He joined our team last year out in Southern California. And I have been stalking some of his really wonderful Facebook Live sessions. If you have not seen them, you really should check them out. They're on a couple of platforms, but you can visit his page, his Facebook page. So that's, if you look for a diplomat in residence, Southern California, you will see them all archived there. All sorts of really interesting subjects. So check them out.
Okay.
All right. We still have folks who are joining, but we want to be respectful of your time. Good evening, I'm Yolanda Kearney. I'm the diplomat in residence for the DC Metro region. I am joined this evening, as you heard, with my colleague diplomat in residence, Jason Borstraza, who covers Southern California, Nevada, Guam, and Hawaii, and Samoa. Correct, Jason? Ta-da! Also with Ambassador Ronald Newman and Ambassador Tom Miller. With that, I'm going to turn it over to Ambassador Newman so that he can get us started, introduce us all, and then we'll have a chat about the political career track.
Well, Yolanda, thank you very much. I will say that a brief moment of introduction about the Academy. The Academy, which has been around since 1983, started by people like Henry Kissinger, George Kennan, has a small group of former senior diplomats, and it really has two missions. One is talking to Americans about why diplomacy is important, and the other is talking to the State Department and our colleagues about how they could do their job better. And in the first mission, we're very interested in promoting the Foreign Service. The Academy is not all former Foreign Service officers, but it has probably a majority of them, but it has some that are non-career and some who come from a background of intelligence and military and other things. And then occasionally we lose them because they turn around and go back into government. In fact, we have, I think, 16 members out of our 380 are in the current administration. And they better up their game so we don't look like a purely partisan organization. Anyway, a couple of years ago, actually it's almost two now, we had a panel that one of our interns at the Academy had put on, part of their regular project, to talk about the Foreign Service. And they worked with Yolanda. And out of that came this idea of doing a series of panels, one for each cone. Because as you probably have figured out by this time, otherwise, why would you be here? That when you take the Foreign Service exam, you have to designate a cone or a specialty. I don't really know why we have that word, but we can't seem to get unstuck from it. So there we are. And it used to be that this was kind of a convenience and you could, you could think about changing. Now it is extremely difficult to change. And so the cone you pick is very likely to be the cone you will be in if you get in. And not only that, it's very likely to be the cone in which you will stay for a decade or more, or conceivably for your whole career. And so it's really important that you make that choice correctly. And the notion of this panel, which I give full credit to for Yolanda, because it was her idea, was to put a former senior diplomat with somebody, a diplomat in residence who's currently in the cone, to talk about what the career is like in that particular cone from these different perspectives. And so we've got Jason, who's still in the Foreign Service and has had a very interesting career. We've got Ambassador Tom Miller, Ambassador from Greece, various other places, who has had a very active after the Foreign Service career as well, with an NGO, with working in Afghanistan, a place I have some familiarity with. And so with that introduction and brief commercial announcement, I will mention one other thing. If you are interested in the Foreign Service, and I assume you must be, otherwise why would you be listening to this at this hour of the evening? There are two podcasts which the Academy maintains. They're both on our website, academyofdiplomacy.org. And one is called American Diplomat, and it is a series of just very listenable accounts of different people's lives and experiences, all kinds of things from trying to figure out how to get a death certificate for somebody that was brought back stiff in a car from Mexico, right up to political problems and refugee evacuations. And it's called General and the Ambassador, and is a series of conversations, a little more policy focused, I suppose, between former commanding officers, generals, and the ambassadors they worked with. And it gives you a real insight into different aspects of how we work with the military. So with those commercial announcements out of the way, Yolanda, let me pass this back to you.
Thank you so much, sir. So I'd like to start, Ambassador Miller and Jason, our two political officers, with that wonderful question. Tell us a little bit about yourselves and your career as political officers, and then let's talk a little bit about what political career track work is and is not. So, Ambassador Miller, we have shared your really interesting biography, but tell us a little bit about yourself, your career, and some highlights of political work.
Okay. Well, I joined the Foreign Service in 1976 and retired in 2005, 29 years. And my real background is Southeast Asia. I got my PhD in political science, but a focus on Southeast Asia. And my first job in the Foreign Service was related to Southeast Asia in our Bureau of Intelligence and Research. And the first point I want to make is kind of characteristic of my career, which is when I came in, I thought I wanted to do Southeast Asia my whole life. And things came up. And they kept on coming up in my career where I got new opportunities, worked a lot on the Middle East. We went to Greece three times as the political officer, as a in the 80s, as the deputy chief of mission, that's like the deputy ambassador, in the 90s, and then back as ambassador. And that was kind of very, very interesting. Why did we go to Greece the first time? We were looking for good schools for our kids. And elementary schools. So my career is one of happenstance, and it all worked out really, really well. I was before ambassador to Greece, I was ambassador to Bosnia right after the war. And I didn't know anything about Bosnia, but Madeleine Albright and her colleagues were looking for a crisis manager, so I'm told, and rather than an area expert. And so I was asked to go to Bosnia. And, if you have to have certainty for the next 20 years, the Foreign Service is not for you. If you are the kind of person who wants to, have adventures, and the Foreign Service is not a job, it's a life, then the Foreign Service can definitely be for you. The last thing I'd say, and you have my bio, so I'm not going to go through each of the things that I've done, is that if you have a significant other, it's really important to have that, or a projected significant other, it's really important to have that conversation with that person before you join. And the reason why is this might be a great life for you, but it might not be a great life for the other person who is going to launch on this adventure with you. Same with kids with special needs. and we did have kids with special needs. You just got to check it out. It worked out great for us. The State Department has great programs for kids who have special needs. And so it's not a deal breaker at all, but it's something that you need to have a conversation beforehand. Let me stop there, Yolanda, and turn it over to Jason, and he can talk a little bit about what he did.
Thank you, Ambassador Miller. So I have been in the Department of State in the Foreign Service since 2004, so about 17 and a half years. I came to the Foreign Service after 6 years at the U.S. Department of Labor in Los Angeles. And, in those days, it wasn't uncommon that you might have 4 years of consular work. And that was true for me. So I had 2 years in Kingston in the consular section, and then 2 years in Hong Kong. Also, I should mention, I came in, I got extra points for speaking Mandarin, but I have yet to be assigned to a Mandarin speaking post. So kind of like what Ambassador Miller was saying, things happen, you never know how your skill sets are going to be used or not used. It did actually help me for getting the Hong Kong assignment because they were looking for someone who already had Mandarin speaking background for the Mandarin to Cantonese conversion course, which I took for a few months before going to Hong Kong. Most of my career since that time has been focused on congressionally mandated reports, either for the Bureau of East Asia and Pacific Affairs. These are reports like the Trafficking in Persons Report, Human Rights Report, Religious Freedom Report, or for the Bureau of Democracy, Human Rights, and Labor. And then overseas, I've been in Tijuana, and that grew out of my experience as the Chile desk officer, where I was the one person covering everything on U.S.-Chilean relationship. And fortunately, I had some Spanish when I came in, not very much. But during that time on the Chile desk, I was able to improve my Spanish and then took a little bit more Spanish before going to Tijuana as the head of the political, economic, and what we call ESTH, or Environment, Science, Technology, and Health section. It was combined all those issues for two people. So it was a very busy assignment, but it was a great assignment. I was there for 4 years. And then I went from there to Democracy, Human Rights, and Labor that I mentioned earlier. And then after two assignments in Democracy, Human Rights, and Labor, came to this position as the recruiter for Southern California and a few other places. So, I haven't had yet a traditional political officer position at an embassy. We'll see if that happens at some point in the future. But, the assignments have been great so far, and they've been as kind of what along the lines of what Ambassador Miller was saying, they've worked very well for my family. So Yolanda, with that, I'll turn it back over to you.
Thank you both. And so the first question, and I think Jason and I get this a lot as diplomats in residence, is what exactly is political work? I thought I'll quote some of candidates that I've talked with. I thought everything you guys did was political. So what is it exactly? Ambassador Miller, I look at the structure of this bureau, the Bureau of, there's an undersecretary for political affairs in the Bureau. So what is it? What is political work and political career track work?
Well, political work, you caught me at a good time, Yolanda, because I just taught a mini course on what does a political officer do. So if you see me looking off to the side, I'm looking at some of my notes that I used. But your responsibility, first of all, it's nothing like when I came in, because two things have happened that are revolutionary. Number one, you have the internet. And number two, you have 24-hour news cycle. Neither of those things were around when I came in. And that vastly changes what a political officer does. You now no longer have the ability to report the news first. It's already been reported by the time you wake up, or by the time the people in Washington wake up. Your job is to provide analysis. Your job is to interpret what's happened and what it means to the U.S. government. How important it is for the U.S. government. Not everything that you follow is of tremendous importance to the U.S. government. And that's your job, is to sort through that and to provide analysis. Jason said you have a bunch of reports that are congressionally mandated that a political section does. And I'll leave that to Jason because he's been doing that. I've never actually, I've contributed to these, some of these reports, and I've used them when I was ambassador, but I'll let Jason talk about that. You also have a responsibility to identify opportunities that maybe people in Washington aren't paying attention to. You're the person on the front lines, and you might see an opportunity for a particular initiative with the country that you're stationed in that no one in Washington has thought about. So your job is not just to handle the inbox. That's part of it, but is to take initiative that's consistent with what you understand to be U.S. interest. Your job is definitely to promote U.S. interest with the host government. Regardless, it could be bilateral interest, that is relationships between our country and U.S. and the country you're stationed in, or it could be multilateral, that is all kinds of UN issues and other stuff like that. And again, my strong experience and advice is don't just work the inbox, don't just do what Washington tells you to do. Your job, you know, the Foreign Service is pretty selective. Your job is to figure out how to do it most effectively. And that's your responsibility. No one's going to tell you how to do it. And it is your responsibility to figure out, you know, exactly what to do. And along those lines, you'll often get talking points from Washington. We want you to make the following points to the host government. You can modify them. You know, if you modify them greatly, you should probably go back to Washington. But if you modify them to be more effective with the host government, that's fine. You know things, you know nuances, you know things that are happening in that country that you're stationed in that others in Washington don't know. I could go on, but let me stop there.
Jason, tell us about these congressionally mandated reports that are due. Obviously, writing is important for every career track in the Foreign Service, but as a reporting officer, what is that?
Yeah, so I think as a political officer, you know, you have to be somewhat outgoing, right? Because you're going to have to be out and making these connections so that you can find out the information that is necessary for these reports. I mentioned three of them in particular that are often the responsibility, almost always, I would say, responsibility of the political section, or it might even be a combined political economic section. That's not unusual, particularly at a smaller post. But that would be the human rights report, sort of the, you know, the best known, I guess, of our long-running congressionally mandated reports, trafficking in persons report, and then the international religious freedom report. So it's not uncommon as a, you know, entry-level or low-level person in the political section that you would be tasked with updating or drafting, depending on the report. Maybe you're answering questions from Washington about it too, but you know, you need to have those connections, right? So that means, you know, meeting with the local religious leaders so that you understand what's happening for religious freedom issues. Also, obviously, watching what's happening in the press, but you, I think in almost every case, to the, you know, it depends, may depend on the location where you are, how easy this is to do, but I've been fortunate in the places that I've been that it has been pretty easy to set up meetings with, you know, local religious leaders to find out, or on human rights issues, talking to local human rights activists, whether they're from non-governmental organizations, or maybe you're in a location where there's some sort of government human rights agency. When I was in Tijuana, there was a state-run human rights commission that I met with fairly regularly, but there were also quite a lot of non-governmental organizations that I met with regularly. And then for trafficking in persons in Tijuana, for example, there was a trafficking in person shelter that I would visit on occasion, met with various other activists. And again, there were government people, both, you know, sort of on the prosecution side, but also on the kind of social services side for trafficking victims that I would talk to as well. But kind of getting along, going back to what Ambassador Miller was saying, it's not enough to make those connections and find out what's happening. You have to write about it. You know, and the balance may depend on the post, but in Tijuana, I found it was generally the case that if I spent two-thirds of my time, maybe even three-quarters of my time out of the office or doing meetings, you know, maybe some of those would be in the office too, then I needed to set aside one-third or perhaps one-quarter of my time to write. Now, not, you know, the congressionally mandated reports are kind of on a schedule. You know, there's certain times you need to or respond to those. But, you know, as Ambassador Miller was saying, you may also decide, hey, you know, something has happened in this particular sector with, you know, human rights or whatever it might be. And so I want to write a report on it. So, you know, you can take the initiative to write a report even outside of when those reports are due. But you will have to contribute to those reports when they come around. In a place like Tijuana too, I was also had this other layer of the embassy in Mexico City that was, you know, looking for input from me, but also from the other 9 consulates. So trying to, you know, they were coordinating that input, and then it was going into this major report that's put out in Washington. But it's still, in my experience in general, it was still possible to, you know, write something about development related to human rights or, you know, international religious freedom, trafficking in persons outside of when the schedule was due as well.
Yolanda,
can I just add one thing, if I may, Yolanda? We've been talking about the what so far, and Jason made an excellent point about take the initiative. You don't have to just wait from Washington to get a message for an instruction from Washington. But there's also the how and the why. And this is kind of the essence of what a political officer does. That political officer is responsible, a good political officer should form contacts among a wide variety of people, not just parliamentarians and ministers or vice ministers and stuff like that, but people in the academic world, people in human rights, you know, the whole range of things. I'm going to miss if I keep on listening, but that's your job is to have these contacts. And it's very helpful if you have the language, and we do provide language training for folks because all the contacts will be much more comfortable talking in their language than in yours. And so the how is very, very important. Sorry, Bob.
I just like to back that up because as Tom, Ambassador Miller was saying, the interpretive function has gone up in importance, even as perhaps you're less required to be on the cutting edge of news. Although in a lot of countries, the news isn't covered at all. Certain crisis countries are covered constantly, even if badly, and many others aren't covered by the American media at all. But knowing how to interpret the news, what something means, development means, that takes a lot of this kind of contact work. It takes a lot of working to look at different sources and make sure you're not reporting just what one person told you. The other thing, to go back to an earlier comment, is this business of writing. There was a question in the chat about writing as well. The one criticism I continue to hear from senior colleagues who are still in the State Department is poor writing skills on people who come in. And the need is basically to write clearly, in clear sentences, to organize things well, to get your message out quickly. I mean, when I was a Deputy Assistant Secretary, I probably would get, I don't know, a 3 or 4 inch stack, maybe, of printed cables. We weren't all online at that point, but it gives you more of a visual notion. It's larger now. And I was busy too. And I would say that I looked at a lot of those messages and I looked at the summary paragraph. And I looked at that paragraph to tell me, do I care about this message? And why should I care about this message? That paragraph was well written, I probably read it. If it was a really long message, I might read it and I might have to put it aside for the weekend. If that paragraph was badly written, I generally trashed it right then. If you can't write, and you need to work on this, not everybody can have great style, but you can constantly work on editing yourself. If your sentence goes on and on, look at how to make it shorter. Talk about simple declarative sentences. You can clean up your prose, but you have to become your own editor. And people seem to have gotten used to kind of verbal meandering, particularly with computers, I suppose, but maybe not. I don't know what the genesis is, but the result is people do not organize well. They do not write succinctly. They do not write quickly and short. And if you're going to learn anything, if you're going to work on a skill you really need as a political officer, work on that one. Because if you cannot write quickly, clearly, in short form, you're not real useful.
If I could just add to that just for a second, because I'd like to share a story. I came into the Foreign Service. I was a freshly minted PhD. I thought I was God's gift to the world. And I was so used to professors who would tell me, expand on this, amplify on this. And so, and my dissertation was several inches thick and all. And so that's what I was used to. And my first boss in the Foreign Service was this little old biddy who was well into her 70s. And she returned my first paper with totally redlined throughout. And I was crushed. And she sat down with me. You know, I thought my career was going to be very short. She sat down with me. She said, look, you've always been writing for a different audience, an academic audience. And now you're writing for, just as Ron says, busy people who have way too much to read. And you got to say it quickly and succinctly. And that summary paragraph is extremely important. So that's the Foreign Service. You know, and it's not making any judgment about what's better, what's worse, or anything like that. But it, you know, most of you are coming out of academia at some point, and you know, you're used to people saying, your professors saying, amplify on this, expand on this. I want more details. I want more footnotes. That's not the way you write in the Foreign Service for a very busy audience.
Pastor Miller, you have taken me back to the beginning of my career. I also came out of academia, and yes, every cable is not a dissertation. That's a hard lesson to learn when we first start. So I want to go back to the structure of your bureau. So again, looking at the Undersecretary for Political Affairs, and it is not structured like other undersecretariats. So I see all of these, you know, there's an assistant secretary and secretariat for Western Hemisphere Affairs and African Affairs and Southeast Asian Affairs. What's this geographic? How does this work out? And how did they come to nest under political affairs? And how does that work when you're at an embassy?
Okay, so early in my career, I was a special assistant to our undersecretary for political affairs. And that's the person who's above all of the bureaus, the regional bureaus. And that person is responsible, he's the boss of all the regional bureaus, the Near East, East Asia, Latin America, Africa, et cetera. And all the information, you know, that person is responsible for these bureaus, and the assistant secretaries of each of these bureaus report to that person. Now that person is usually the most senior Foreign Service officer in the State Department, and usually a very close confidant of the Secretary of State. And so the nexus of information and policy, et cetera, flows through that office. And I'm not saying every single thing is handled. A lot of things are handled at the bureau level, one level below, or sometimes at the office director level. But the kind of key issues that appear before the geographic assistant secretary, the geographic bureaus go through the undersecretary for political affairs. Very important job. That person at the time, I don't know what it is now, but I was one of four special assistants. I was the most junior. So I was the guy who got in early in the morning, like 5:30 or so, went through the gobs of traffic that Ron is describing. And literally you'd have several inches of paper. And, you know, the undersecretary wasn't expected to read that stuff. I was expected to go through all of it and have the important stuff ready for them. So there's a lot of sorting out and, you know, kind of consolidating of information. The one thing that I will say is we definitely function under information overload. There's just too much. And I'm not pointing the finger. It's just the important thing for that office is to make sure that the big boss gets the right information and can act on it. And that's policy recommendations that either that guy will take or that person will take and right now it is a woman, or will suggest that the Secretary of State or one of the deputy secretaries take.
Question for each of you, actually, Ambassador Newman and Ambassador Miller. Jason, you've talked about this endless news cycle. And so CNN, for our candidates, CNN is going to tell you what happened. There were tires burning outside of the embassy. The political officer is going to tell you, so what? What does that mean? Are tires burning because the opposition has mounted a coup, or are tires burning because teachers haven't been paid in 3 months and they and their students are protesting? So I think that we have a strong handle on what this work looks like out in an embassy or a consulate. But what about domestically? We spend about a third of the career in the United States. What did this work look like domestically? Ambassador Miller's talked about being a special assistant. I'd like to hear from Jason, Ambassador Newman. What does it look like when you're doing political work back in the United States? Jason, why don't you start us off?
Sure. So in the US, part of your job is to work with the post, right? Depending on the position you're in, but it's very common that a political officer at some point during their career would serve as a desk officer. I think I mentioned earlier, I was the Chile desk officer. So I was reading all of the traffic that was coming from what was then, and I think is still, a combined political economic section at our embassy in Santiago. So part of that, again, was, you know, there were other people in my bureau, which was the Bureau of Western Hemisphere Affairs, who might be interested in some of that. So sometimes it was a matter of, you know, helping direct it to the right place, but also maybe working with the special assistants who are working with the assistant secretary, the head of the Bureau of Western Hemisphere Affairs, to make sure any important items were getting up to that level. As a desk officer, though, I was seeing everything. I mean, I was the only one, as I mentioned earlier, so I saw things related to public diplomacy, consular, all the different career tracks. But you know, when it was time for things like the, you know, we talked about the congressionally mandated reports, when it was time for Chile's input into the embassy and Chile's input into those, I would often work with my counterparts in the Bureau of Western Hemisphere Affairs, the embassy, but then also in one part that we didn't really talk about so much, except I think I briefly mentioned working in the Bureau of Democracy, Human Rights, and Labor, are the functional bureaus. There are the functional bureaus also that have an important role, you know, whether it's political military affairs, which I worked with quite closely because we have a lot of U.S. Chilean military cooperation, or international narcotics and law enforcement affairs, again, because there's some cooperation there. Democracy, Human Rights, and Labor for the Human Rights Report, or then there's specific offices that deal with the trafficking in persons, or the International Religious Freedom Report. So as the in Washington, I found a lot of my job was just kind of coordinating and making sure that everyone was aware of these different, you know, initiatives that were happening. And then to some extent also touching base with people at other agencies, especially as the desk officer, you know, whether that was Department of Commerce or USAID or, you know, Department of Defense.
Ambassador Newman, as the ambassador, as the chief of mission, what are you expecting to receive from political officers in Washington? Other than we've heard about instructions about congressionally mandated reports, but what are you expecting to receive?
From Washington, I want to know, first of all, of course, what my instructions are. I want to know what my instructions might become so that I could weigh in, because generally an activist ambassador wants to participate in giving, structuring his or her instructions. It doesn't want to be just on the receiving end of these things. I want to have a very highly sort of attuned notion of what is going on with the bureaucracy and what is happening. And if there's an issue that's hung up, where is it hung up? And where in the different agencies or different bureaus is the problem? And what's the problem? Is the problem one that I like because it's keeping something stupid from happening? Or is the problem one I don't like because it's getting in the way of my doing something I think I should be doing? So I'm looking particularly to the desk officer, the country director, to keep me informed at a very high level of detail on what is going on. Now, this is political work in a different sense. This is the political work of knowing the U.S. government, which is a large, messy conglomerate that does not coordinate well. And it takes a great deal of skill to do well in the bureaucracy. And it's not exclusive to political officers. Most of these desk jobs and others in Washington are listed as interfunctional jobs. They can be held by people of any cone. Political officers may have a slight edge for some of them, but they really hone your skills. They're also very important jobs to have for a political officer, because it's where you learn essentially your clientele. You know, who are you reporting for when you're in the field? You're not writing for an abstract academic audience. You're writing for a complex of bureaus and agencies who have policy interests. The better you understand your clients, the better you service them. So it's very important if you're a political officer or pretty much any kind of Foreign Service officer, really, to have these kind of desk jobs fairly early on in your career. So you get a sense of the organization you're working for, whether you like Washington or not. But you need to know Washington, and you need to know how to play in the Washington arena if you're going to go up.
Ambassador Miller, I've heard a couple of things now that sort of pique my interest. The first is this concept of understanding the interagency. That's, you know, you have to be able to do that. The second is, Jason mentioned political military, Paul Mill work. So can you talk a little about, other than sort of quote unquote straight political work, the other things that are in that portfolio? And then I'd like to hear from each of you about the other parts of the interagency. Where do we overlap with the Department of Defense, for example, and USAID and others?
Okay, first the interagency. Ron hit it on the head. Your job in Washington is to range widely, not just the State Department, but to, because there are a number of agencies that have a big interest in the country you're working in. And, I'll just give you an example that came up when I was ambassador in Greece, and it's now another, you know, it's come up again as of today, and that's the Olympics. You know, we've decided we're not going to send a representation, a diplomatic representation, which could be very high level people, to the games. We're going to allow the athletes to compete. We had similar discussions when I was in Athens for the 2004 games. So and there are many, many players in the interagency that are involved in this thing. And some even aren't even in the interagency. In this case, the U.S. Olympic Committee is a very important player. It's not part of the U.S. government, but, you know, you have to range widely. You have to know who the players are and what their influence is. What was the second question again? I'm sorry.
In addition to the interagency, what does the overlap? Yes, Paul Mill, labor, okay. And other.
Mm-hmm. Okay. In some larger embassies, and in Athens, we had a political military section that work very closely with the political section, but their emphasis was on anything that had to do with the military to military relationship between the US and Greece. And in this case, we sell a lot of equipment to the Greeks, a lot of US military equipment. And we have a lot of different kinds of relationships, exercises, what have you. And the political military person in an embassy is the one responsible for that. Back in the department, there's also political military work. I was actually, there's a Bureau for Political Military Affairs that is the interface with the Pentagon. And I was actually in one of my early jobs, the political military officer on the Israeli-Palestinian, in the Israeli-Palestinian office. And at the time, and most of it, believe it, you know, this is before we even had any relationship with the Palestinians in the early 80s. So it was all with Israel, and we had an extremely robust relationship with Israel on the military to military side. So it's a lot of it's detail, but a lot of it's very, very important detail. And this is a perfect example of where the interagency is so important, because one of the big players is the Pentagon, and you have to coordinate and work really, really closely with the Pentagon.
Thank you. Jason, I would like to hear an example of your Paul military work. There are a couple of questions that have popped up already. Yes, all of these sessions are going to be recorded. The Academy has been kind enough to host them. So at the end of the series, the last of which is the 11th of December, that's a Saturday at 2. After the series is over, we're going to compile them. They're going to reside right here on the Academy's website. So Jason, tell us,
we don't have them yet. We will have them all when you give them to us. But,
correct. Jason, can you tell us about your Paul Mill out in the field? What did Paul Mill work look like? We have lots of veterans who are trying to figure out how they can parlay their veterans experience into a State Department career.
So out in the field, it may depend on where you are. So when I was in Tijuana, it didn't come up nearly as often as it might have, say, in Mexico City, where, you know, we had the defense attaché and other representatives of the Department of Defense. Most of my Paul Mill experience actually came on the Chile desk in Washington, where I was regularly working with the Department of Defense, and then the Chilean defense attachés. There were a couple of them at the time. In the case of Tijuana, it was actually a bit of a hybrid in the sense that it was not uncommon for me to work with Mexican military authorities, but on the US side, it would be the Department of Homeland Security, you know, such as the Coast Guard or Border Patrol or some other sort of agency that was, you know, related to issues that were happening at the border. So that was, in Tijuana at least, that was about the extent of my work with on Paul Mill, although on the US side, it wasn't, you know, military agencies, you know, that you would think of traditionally like Army, Navy, or things like that.
Paul Mill was a major part of my career. Various different aspects from when being Jordan officer, desk officer, and coordinating with the Pentagon for a then secret plan to possibly go into Saudi Arabia with Jordan, to later on working in Algeria, where the issues were figuring out whether the revolution was going to win, to being in Iraq, where I was the main liaison with the military command, and everything involved us both, you know, to Afghanistan, obviously, where General Eikenberry and I would meet at least once a week, and he recognized that he wasn't going to get out if we didn't do well in things like economics and reform that were my responsibility, and everything he did in the military operational area bore on political issues as well. So we simply had to coordinate. One of the things that I've seen is this is hugely personality dependent, because the first place where the military and the civilian lines of command actually come together, the President of the United States, there is no lower person who is in charge of both. And it really helps to understand both cultures because they are very different. That's a separate lecture. I won't do it now, but learning to talk to each other is real skill that not every civilian has, frankly, not every military officer has. They can spend too much time bad-mouthing the other one if they don't understand why they're different.
So true, so interestingly true, really. I'd like to talk for our candidates. So you've got this gleam in your eye and you're certain that you want to join the Foreign Service, which is great. I live on Capitol Hill, so I'm giving you some Capitol Hill ambiance back there with the siren. So what I want you to do is think about the arc of this career. And to do that, Jason, I'd like you to tell us a little bit about what this work looks like early and mid-career. And then Ambassador Miller and Ambassador Newman, tell us what political work looks like later in the career as a senior political officer. So Jason, take us through earlier in the career and up through mid-level.
Yeah, so I think I mentioned earlier that, you know, congressionally mandated reports are not an unusual thing to be assigned early in your career, and that's absolutely true. You know, that I think almost every political section in the world gives the responsibility for updating those to the most junior person in the office, because it can be a bit drudgery sometimes, in the sense you've got to, you know, gather information. I mean, maybe not just yourself, but also from other parts of the embassy or consulate where you're assigned. So, and it does involve writing in a particular skill set. So it is useful. It is useful to learn how to do, but, you know, you do have to follow instructions, and the instructions are usually quite lengthy for these congressionally mandated reports. You have to follow those closely. It would also be common as a political officer that you would be a site officer for a visit, maybe by the ambassador or some other high-level person. That means you would be the person at a particular site. You probably wouldn't be responsible for the entire visit, but you would probably be responsible for some small part of it. You would probably also be involved with things like, you know, election observation. Again, probably not as the lead if there's, you know, a large number of people going out to observe elections, but you would probably...
I'm sorry, can we go back? So I'm a site officer, or I'm assigned. What does that mean exactly? What am I doing?
So, you know, it typically in a visit, let's just say from an ambassador or, you know, an assistant secretary or deputy assistant secretary, they would visit several different locations, right? And when they are coming, they're usually on the ground for a relatively short amount of time. And it's usually a fairly packed schedule because they want to take advantage of the short time that they're there to learn about whatever the issue is that they're focused on. So these visits, not always, but usually you have a fair amount of planning that goes into them to the extent that it's possible. Sometimes, you know, something comes up and someone comes quickly, but generally you'll know fairly far in advance. And as a site officer, you know, that means that you're responsible for basically everything from like, where are the bathrooms and where can I get water, to, you know, making sure that the person from the other side that they're supposed to meet with, or that the place that they're going to visit, is ready to receive them, right? And typically in this kind of scenario, you as a site officer go to that site probably several hours in advance of this VIP visitor arriving and make sure that everything is ready to go. And then you're in touch with whoever is accompanying, usually again, you know, someone else from the embassy or consulate, whoever is accompanying that VIP will be usually giving updates. You know, we're at this location, sometimes things are running behind or whatever. And then, you know, you as the site officer can have a fair amount of independence, I guess I should say, or maybe responsibility. I remember one site officer, I was the person, you know, accompanying the ambassador, and he wanted something printed at the airport where we had someone as the site officer. So I remember like frantically texting the person at the airport saying, you need to find a place to go print this before we get there. Fortunately, she was able to do that. But you know, that's the sort of thing that a site officer might have to do. Another time I remember a site officer being told that, you know, this particular visitor smoked and didn't have cigarettes. And so was asked to go out and buy cigarettes for the visitor. I don't know how often that would happen nowadays. This was a few years ago. But anyway, you know, you basically are there to try to respond to whatever happens, right? And be ready then when the person arrives to take them where it's going to go. You've gone through it already with the person who's there at the site. So.
Thank you. And so Ambassador Miller, at the senior ranks of a political career, what do those positions look like? What are those responsibilities like? And what can people aspire to?
Okay, let me try to cover mid and senior ranks, because there's, I would add one thing to Jason's thing, and that is you're often a note taker in meetings. And that can be very, very important. This comes back to something that Ron said earlier. Your job isn't just to be a stenographer. Your job is to write up the notes of a meeting in a way that hits the high points, hits the critical things, and you have to produce a cable that captures the essence of what the busy policymakers have to know. So you're not a stenographer by any means, and you do this overseas. You do it in Washington as well. Now, as you go through the ranks, in Washington, you start off as a desk officer. And then when you get to be probably early senior ranks, you could be, you can be a, an office director, and then above that is a deputy assistant secretary, and goes up from there. The office director is exactly that. That person is responsible for everything. If it's a country desk or a number of countries, that person is responsible for all things that happen in the area of the geographic area of responsibility. I've been an office director a couple times. I'll leave it for Ron to describe what a deputy assistant secretary does, because he's been that several times, and as well as assistant secretary. And those people I've seen in the chat box, you know, a bunch of you have asked, are these foreign service officers or not? First of all, I want to make two points. Number one, we are not civil servants. We have a separate category called foreign service officer. And it's distinct in many ways from being a civil servant. There are some similarities. We have a retirement system, et cetera. But what you're all talking about is taking an exam to become a foreign service officer. Overseas, at the mid and senior mid and kind of junior senior levels, lower senior levels, you're the head of a section, head of the political section. And that's a very key job. You run all of the matters of the political officers in your section. And, you know, it can range, as Jason was saying, you could have, in some smaller embassies, you might combine the political and economic section, and therefore the head of the section would be the counselor for political and economic affairs. But in larger embassies, and when I was ambassador, both Greece and Bosnia at the time were very large embassies, we had, 7-10 officers in the political section. And you're the interface between the ambassador and the people who work for you. You're not going to be writing a lot of reports or stuff like that. The people who work for you are going to be writing the reports. You're going to be doing a lot of editing. You're going to be doing a lot of policy direction, because you're expected at that point to understand the policy, to be an advisor to the ambassador. And you often get your input from your political officers who work for you, who are out in the streets, who are getting around and kind of gathering all kinds of information that might not be available on the news. So that's kind of the basic. I left the deputy assistants, kind of the front office, to Ron.
Yeah, thanks. A few comments. One, reporting is getting more and more important, and it's getting harder, because one of the problems of having good computer interface is that people can get stuck behind their computers answering questions from Washington, from a great many people in Washington, because there's not much discipline in asking questions. One of the tasks of an ambassador is to make sure his people or her people get out, to give them the top cover to say to Washington, I can't answer you today or maybe even this week because I've got other things to do, for the ambassador. So I firmly believe that ambassadors can get good political reporting done, but they may have to insist that it be the priority of the section, because people will be competing for attention with Washington. One person asked in your chat, I think it's germane to this, what can I do to stand out? And I would say what you can do to stand out is master your brief. You're not going to impress me because you're God's gift to the Foreign Service. You will impress me if you really, really know your subject. You may not be able to know Afghanistan better than I do, but you can know the piece you're working on so well that your ideas are sensible. And that's really important. As far as Deputy Assistant Secretary, now this has changed because we've had a proliferation of Deputy Assistant Secretaries. I think we've had too many. And I personally think we've downgraded the country director a bit. And too many of them have become paper pushers staffing the DAS's deputy assistant secretary. You'll have to get used to state speak. But the DAS's are the critical element underneath the assistant secretary in keeping the different pieces of the bureau going and keeping the policy. And now you'll see that in some cases, the DAS's also become double-hatted as special envoys. so that the guy working on Afghanistan now as the special envoy since Ambassador Khalilzad left is a fellow named Tom West, who's also the DAS in the South Asia Bureau. The Tim Landerking, who's the Deputy Assistant Secretary of the Middle East Bureau, is also the special envoy charging around trying to get some traction on peace in Yemen. And so you can be pretty high, you know, you can have pretty high level responsibilities. I remember at one point I was country director when I was sent out on a combined state and defense trip with Wolfowitz at that point and told to somehow keep this guy in line. And that was an interesting job. So you can have a lot of different things going for you as a DAS.
I one of these days, Ambassador Newman, you and I are going to have to sit down and have a talk about what that tour was like for you. So I want to make sure that we leave lots of time for questions, and there are many of them in the chat. And also, if you have not typed them in the chat and would like to ask your question, simply use the reactions button at the bottom. You can raise a hand. I do have something I'd like you to do. I have a very, very quick poll for you. Or we thought we had a poll for you. My good friends here at, let's see. So I don't have a poll for you. So we'll go right into your questions. But I do want to take a couple of them. There have been some things that have sort of bubbled up. The first are the fellowships and the diplomatic fellowships. Two that lead to employment as Foreign Service Officers. Those are Pickering and Rangel. And we'll put a link to those. Those are for graduate level study. So these are for either undergraduates who are graduating, or if you have already graduated from your undergraduate studies and are looking at a master's degree program in a field that's related to the Foreign Service. The application period for those typically opens in September or thereabouts in the fall. And so we'll put a link to both those programs. So they are mentorship programs in that you are matched with a mentor for the 2 years of the duration of the program. They are internship programs in that you have a domestic internship at either the State Department for the Pickering program or with a member of Congress on the Hill for Rangel. And then each of them has an overseas component for an internship at an embassy or consulate. They are pure fellowships in that they provide funding for graduate study, but most importantly, they are employment programs. They are meant to lead to, and they do lead to, employment as Foreign Service Officers. So those are meant for women and minorities, including geographic minorities. So if you are from the Midwest, or if you're from Appalachia, you're someplace that is not typically represented in the Foreign Service, those programs are also open to you. So we'll put a quick link to those in the chat. There's a question about whether or not a reservist can serve. We do have Foreign Service Officers who and specialists who honor their commitments to their reserve commitments. So that is something that absolutely happens. There was a question about how you work with public diplomacy. And I, as a public diplomacy career track officer, definitely appreciate that question, because frequently Paul and PD have many of the same contacts. We are working on issues from a slightly different perspective, but certainly at the ministerial level, political officers and public diplomacy officers have many of the same contacts, because we're working on issues in a similar way. Once the series is over, I urge you to go back and take a look at all 5 career tracks. Somebody asked which career tracks there are. There are 5, consular, public diplomacy, political management, and dun, 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 I don't hear it, econ. So those are our 5. And then there were some questions about bidding and work life. But first, Genevieve, why don't you unmute yourself and ask your question?
Hi, my question is for you, Jason. I would like to ask, I'm actually an applicant to the State Department internship program at the consulate in Tijuana. And I'm wondering what your experience has been with interns, if you could talk a bit about a day in the life of an intern at a consulate, and then also what set apart the interns that you worked with that was most helpful to your work. Thank you.
Sure. So I'll say, first of all, that I was in Tijuana from 2013 to 2017. So I'm not as familiar with the situation right today, although I have had some contacts with the consulate there. But We were a very small section, and it still is a fairly small section. It was I was the head of the political, economic, ESTH, environment, science, technology, and health section. There was one other foreign service officer, and then we had one locally employed staff member. We typically had four Mexican interns because the Mexican universities typically require internships before graduation. So we often got very strong interns from the local universities. And then I tried to always have at least two, but sometimes as many as four US interns from various programs. To be frank, we never had enough applicants in those days. Hopefully they have more now. So I really couldn't be very picky. I mean, I certainly was looking for people who, you know, spoke Spanish and maybe had some experience or interest in the border, but I took people who didn't have that even in the past, because otherwise I wouldn't have had anybody. So, but as far as, you know, daily experiences, I mean, we did try pretty hard. And I think most places around the world try pretty hard to give you a full range of the experiences, you know, so you will get a security clearance as part of being an intern. And so I would bring, you know, interns along to meetings or for, you know, it was the economic section as well, as I said. So we did a lot of factory visits. So I would bring interns along for those, you know, but then there would also be things like maybe even setting up meetings. They would be involved with that because we didn't have an office management specialist, administrative assistant position. We didn't have that in my section. So a lot of times the interns were, part of their role was reaching out to the administrative assistant for whoever we were trying to meet with or the company we were trying to visit to try to set up those kind of meetings. At the time I was there, for most of it anyway, we had to provide basically short snippets on interesting things from the news, right? So the interns also, part of their responsibility was, you know, there at that time there were two main daily papers in Tijuana, one in Ensenada, one in Mexicali, the major cities, one or two in the southern Baja California Sur, and then, you know, some other weekly papers. So we would try to split up the responsibilities between all the interns, depending on the Spanish ability of the US interns, at least, for putting information, you know, of interesting developments that we could put in those weekly reports to the embassy. So those were all various things that they would work on fairly regularly.
Thank you.
I put a link in to the internship program. There are three internship cycles: fall, summer, and spring. And so they come fairly quickly and they are quite far in advance. But the thing to remember is that at every embassy or consulate that's going to host an intern, well in advance, we'll sit down and talk with my team and say, hey, I think we're going to take two or three interns next summer. We look at our strategic planning documents. What are we going to be doing next summer? Then we tease out actual work tasks that we need to have done. So when you look at the job description for those applications, make sure that you are remembering that it's actual work that has to be done. And also make sure that you're writing those internship applications from the view of the person who's going to be the hiring manager, not just how this is going to be great for you academically, but what it is that you bring to the table and that you can offer to that embassy or consulate that's going to host you. Guy, unmute yourself and ask your question.
Hello, and I would like to thank you all for taking the time out of your day to meet with us. My name is Guy Kelly. I'm a former Navy veteran and current graduate student at Georgetown University's Masters of Foreign Service program. And my question is, I understand that, especially now with the application process to become a foreign service officer, is very extensive, very convoluted, and in some cases, very opaque. And it should never be a first resort plan. So what would you recommend on the civil side to kind of get more experience of the foreign service while still residing within DC and trying to work for the State Department on the civil side?
I understand the question correctly, and Jason, help me out. Your question is whether or not it's advantageous to also seek a parallel path as a civil service, in a civil service position, to sort of gain State Department experience before joining the Foreign Service. Is that correct?
Yes, that's essentially it.
Okay, so the hiring authorities are quite different. For Ambassador Miller and myself, you know, the State Department does not care about our doctorates at all. They may as well be wallpaper. To become a Foreign Service officer, there is no academic requirement at all. We so trust our testing process. About 30 years ago, we looked at ourselves and said, if we had to build the perfect Foreign Service officer, what would that look like? And we came up with the 13 Foreign Service dimensions, link in the chat. We have not made a particular credential a requirement because we've not found a particular credential to be a predictor of success in the Foreign Service. If we had, we would say, get that degree and come on in. Instead, we test. The first section is the Foreign Service Officer Test, then the Qualifications Evaluation Panel, which is a largely a review of your writing, your written products. So that is also very key. And then onto the Foreign Service Oral Assessment. So there are some things that maybe, there's some skills that may be transferable between civil service positions and the Foreign Service, but the purpose of the civil services is actually quite different. They are our sort of brain trust on a particular topic or issue. These are people who are going to work on something. The intent when you take the job as a civil servant is that you're going to work on a particular topic or issue for the duration of your career. So the requirements are going to be quite different. You can see these on OPM's website, usajobs.gov. And in that you may see, for example, we're looking for someone to be an Andean affairs specialist. So we're looking for someone with a particular academic background, master's degree in Latin American studies, for example. That's going to be very, very specific. Then the relevant KSAs, knowledge, skills, and abilities. So all of that process is quite different because the way that those jobs are competed is under a different sort of hiring authority, not sort of a different hiring authority completely. So ideally, when everything works together well, you have this deep brain trust of people who know an issue, non-proliferation, let's say, for 20 or 30 years. Then you have someone like me, I go off to my tour, Jason, both ambassadors, we're going to spend 2 or 3 years in a place and then come back. We would, in that instance, come back. I worked on the Guinea desk after I served in Guinea. So I worked also on that desk with people who had deep knowledge of West Africa. They had deep knowledge of that part of West Africa. What I brought to the table as a returning Foreign Service officer was ground truth, having recently come out of that tour. So ideally, all things working together, you have a civil service that is going to be in place for many years with that knowledge base sort of refreshed by Foreign Service officers who are going to take those tours domestically. So all that to say, if the civil service is your long-term goal, that is probably a better approach to it. Those jobs are, as you can see, very highly competitive, very heavily bid, if you will, and lots of applicants, because most people who apply for them do have the intent of being in them for many, many years. All that said, State Department experience on the civil service side is certainly something that can be very useful. Many of our civil service colleagues test into the Foreign Service having served in those positions. That's a long answer to your short question. Anesthesis Scroggins, I can't wait to hear your question. Unmute yourself.
Hi, you guys. I also want to thank you guys for taking the time to explain foreign officer service pathways. So my question for you guys is, sorry, I just got to pull it up. As a Foreign Service officer, what various paths could I undergo with a Criminal Justice Administration degree that's useful within the U.S. State of Diplomacy?
I'm sorry, I lost a little bit of your question. I cut out. Sorry. One more time.
No worries. Let me just pull that right up. Sorry about that. Give me 1 second. So I was just saying, as a Foreign Service officer, what various paths could I undergo with the Criminal Justice Administration degree that would be useful within the U.S. State of Diplomacy?
Please.
I was just going to start. There are a lot of jobs. It wouldn't be a specialty necessarily, but there are a lot of areas that get into the justice field. There is a whole Department of International Law and Narcotics, INL, which we colloquially refer to as drugs and thugs. That has a huge amount of work with the Justice Department all over the world. But there are a lot of jobs where we're interacting. State and AID both have major law enforcement training programs. We have issues, depending on the country, where we have prosecutors detailed overseas. Prosecutors can often be very interesting folks because they're often really expert and they have almost no training in working in teams. And sometimes they need a little handling, control, or a large club. But understanding where they're coming from is helpful. So there are all kinds of jobs in which the background might be useful, but I would not say that it is an area where you would specialize for your whole career.
Let me just, Yolanda, if I can just add, one of the things that I've seen in recent years is the proliferation of FBI offices overseas. We call them legal attachés, but these are FBI people. And they're there because our various interests dictate they should be there, whether it's going after warlords or drug thugs or, you know, any number of people. So that dimension has grown tremendously over the years. And so I agree with Ron, you're not going to have the opportunity to specialize in just this field throughout your career. But my sense is that we're no longer taking just people with political science degrees. That was the old Foreign Service. And, you know, we are interested in physicists. We are interested in people who've got environmental backgrounds, you name it. And so I've seen a bunch of questions in the chat box about, is this or that useful? And the answer to almost all of them is yes. And there is no single career path. Yolanda, if I could just piggyback on a comment you made, because it's very important. When Ron and I came in the Foreign Service, they would often take the smartest person in the room, the person who could answer the most questions, the person who had the factual knowledge. That has changed tremendously. And Yolanda was talking about cooperation within an embassy between, in this case, political officers and public diplomacy people. Now the people who are the most prized and frankly, the most successful in the Foreign Service aren't the ones who can ace an SAT or ace the Foreign Service exam, but they're the people who work well with their colleagues. They're the people who understand what the big picture is. They're the people who don't always have to have their hand in the air before the question is finished. And that's a remarkable change. We want people who cooperate well, who work well together, who work well in teams. That's a big, big difference than when Ron and I came in.
Yeah, I'm gonna share with you what Ambassador Newman and I talked about before this started, and that was just beautiful leadership and how the leadership style has shifted over the years. Ambassador Newman?
Well, I was thinking about what Tom said. It's absolutely true, and yet I was thinking of a line of Kipling that the race is run by two and two, but is won by one and one. It is still a competitive profession. And it's the ability to manage that competitiveness, in a sense, for promotion and work in a team. It's a delicate balance. And it's a matter of learning, in a sense, to be professional. So if you disagree about something or you want something, you push for it, but you do it in a way that keeps your professional ties so that you can come back and work on the next issue. But it's, you know, I think one thing we're saying over and over, you don't know where this profession is going to go. And so you don't know which pieces of your background are going to be the ones that come forward and really help. So don't sweat it too much.
That is the best piece of advice that I have heard all evening and perhaps at all about this process, just in general. Mike, unmute yourself and ask your question.
Hi. Thank you. It's been very informative. I went over the suggested reading list and actually have some of those books. But my question would be, so since the Foreign Service is pretty heavy on, like, you know, writing the cables or the memos, I see, like, you know, things like psychology and anthropology from the reading list. Is the implication that it's like using terms, psychological terms to describe somebody, you know what I mean, like a political official from your host country or something like that. I'm just trying to figure out where the mix of psychology comes in into, like, you know, the suggested reading list. Is it motivation, behavior? Like, what should I focus on?
So thank you for asking the question. And this actually leads me to a question I would love to hear from both ambassadors and Jason. So the suggested reading list actually came out of a recent review of the Foreign Service Officer test questions. And so it extrapolates from those questions that are presented and gives the opportunity to provide a background for the questions that are going to be presented to candidates when you take the FSOT. So one of the things that there's not an intent to make you a psychologist or a practitioner. Instead, the focus is on all the things that you've just heard. Can you get along with people? Imagine that being a major skill for diplomats. For consular work, can you maintain your composure? Consular officers, first of all, have the best stories. They're the best dinner party guests ever. That's the first. Secondly, every Foreign Service officer is a consular officer. That's just the truth of it. There is no place in the world that an American citizen might not find himself or herself imperiled. And so we all complete consular duty for a couple of reasons. The first is there is no better way to get to learn the country that you're in than through consular service. The second is American citizen services. People fall ill. Unfortunately, they pass away overseas. There are American citizens who are adopting, et cetera, et cetera. There are many things that go on with American citizens. And in a pinch, if there is an evacuation or if there's some sort of disaster in country, everyone from the ambassador down to the most recently arrived Foreign Service employee is going to be focused on American citizen services. And for that reason, we all complete consular duty. There's no way to understand the work that we do without completing that. And thank you for the question, because I would love to just a snapshot from both ambassadors and Jason about your the benefit of your consular duty in your later political work.
Well, I guess I'm the exception. I actually had a consular position, but it was at a consulate. A consulate is, you know, the places outside of the capital, a small consulate in Thailand. And we didn't issue visas or any of the other traditional consular work. So my work was largely confined. It was basically a political reporting job disguised as a consular job, because we had a lot of refugees at the time. And we had, this was the center of where the heroin was coming out from the world, the Golden Triangle of Northern Thailand. So I'm not in a position to really talk about traditional consular work, but I do want to say, back to your question, Mike, this job is not unlike other jobs. The people who do well understand people. You don't have to master the psychological terms to describe a foreign leader. You're not a psychologist, and you're not expected to be, but understanding motivations, understanding of leaders, of the people you're dealing with, is extremely important. And as Ron said, understanding your own colleagues is extremely important. If you can't understand and therefore work well with your colleagues, I don't care how brilliant you are, you're not going to make it.
Yeah, you'll be a real pain. You know, on the consular work, I had two jobs with consular function, part of my first tour. And then we had one person in the Gambia who was chargé, and he died, and I got sent down to take over. And I did everything, consular, administrative, political reporting, pushing for UN votes. There's several things about consular. One is, it's one of the earliest jobs in the Foreign Service where you work, where you can have supervisory responsibilities. Political has very few, and econ also has few. Consular, public affairs, and the management cone give you much more early experience in managing people with your local staff. Another thing is, with consular work, you never get away from it in your whole career. As Yolanda said, consular questions are always there. I would say one, you know, piece of advice: if you're not a consular officer by desire, but you're going to be a consular officer for your first or second tour. Pick a small post because you will have a far greater range of actions to responsibilities, and you'll have more responsibilities if you're in a small post where there are one or two consular officers. If you go to a large post where you may do 6 months of non-immigrant visas and 6 months of immigrant visas, it may be a great country, you know, it's a great place if you like to be in Paris and travel. Morale tends to be lower in great big huge consular sections than it is in small ones, but it's a very general piece of advice.
If I can add a little bit more to that question. So I'm gearing towards political or consular, but can I change tracks? Not within the process, but like, can I change? All right. Willingly, you know, I become a foreign service officer, and like, let's say 3 or 5 years down the road, I want to change from like a political officer to an economic officer, for example. Am I able to do that?
I was waiting for that question. And Jason and I, when we talked last week, I'm shocked that no one asked that question until an hour and 25 minutes into the conversation. Jason, it's a very important question, Mike. And Jason's got a great answer for it.
You changed?
No. The basic answer is, I think Yolanda referenced this earlier, it is very difficult to change. So, you know, pick what you want to do, right? And there is a little tool on careers.state.gov that you can go through that will help you determine which is the better fit. Obviously, you can also reach out to your diplomat in residence. There's a lot of videos on my Facebook page, on other people's Facebook pages about the different career tracks, but you want to make sure you pick the one that you are most interested in, because trying to game the system, or, you know, to say like, well, I'll pick this one because I think it's easier to get in and I'll change later, that's very unlikely to happen. I mean, being able to change is tough. I mean, it does happen, but it's not something you should count on. And if I could also just add briefly on, you know, the benefits of consular work, I did 4 years, which is unusual, less common these days, but at that time it wasn't super uncommon. 2 years in Jamaica and then 2 years in Hong Kong. I was running the immigrant visa section after 4 months in Kingston, my very first assignment, supervising locally employed staff, with some of whom had more than 15 years of experience. It took many, many years for me to get experience supervising, you know, as a political officer. And then I would also just say, you know, in addition to perhaps having to work on evacuations or some emergency situation with American citizens, you are almost certainly going to have to be a duty officer, which means that you on the weekends and the evening are answering questions related to American citizens that, you know, have issues outside of regular office hours. So having had, you know, those 4 years of consular work has helped me a lot when I've had to be duty officer, particularly in a place like Tijuana, which is a very busy duty officer location. And then this, the last thing I would say is that, you know, you learn a lot about the society, but also you get to use your language skills. My Cantonese would not be what it is today had I not done 2 years of consular work in Hong Kong. That was a chance to really use it all the time. And, you know, my colleagues in the economic political section, because it was a combined section there, because a lot of their interlocutors spoke really good English, they weren't necessarily, if they even had learned Cantonese, they weren't necessarily using it very frequently. So that's another advantage of the consular work.
I would just say, Mike, to be brutally blunt about it, and since I'm an ex Foreign Service officer, I can be brutally blunt. Don't try to game changing from one cone to the other. That is, everyone knows, I mean, that's been going on for years, and it's very, very difficult to do, very hard to do. I had a friend who came in as an administrative officer in my entering class, and he really wanted to be a political officer. He tried for 25 years and he never did it. If you're going to game something, I was fairly successful at gaming assignments, you know, where you go. And as you develop a reputation over years, I think you have a better chance. It's hard to game assignments in the first couple of tours because no one knows if you're good, bad, or indifferent. But as time goes on, I think that's something that you can have some success with.
Okay, thank you.
You can also work out of cone to a certain extent. There are a lot of jobs which are classed as interfunctional, which you can do no matter what your cone is. The problem is you tend to have to be promoted in your cone. So you can't, you know, if you're a political officer and you decide you like economic work, there's certainly a certain number of jobs you can do where you can do economic work. But if you do too many of them, you won't get promoted.
Okay.
And then you bid it, you bought it.
Okay, that's excellent to know. And I noticed there's other hands up. So thank you very much. But just one more thing, I'm considering taking elementary Chinese, Mandarin, because I've been studying it for a while, but I'll be the elementary / intermediate level. I'm sure that helps, but what do you call it? Can I add to my application if, the more that I progress into Mandarin?
So the short answer is there is no requirement for language at all to join the Foreign Service. At the FOSOA level, the Foreign Service Oral Assessment level, it is possible to augment a score with a language ability. Jason did so, I did so coming in with tested language ability, but that is much farther along at the FOSOA level. Okay. And if you receive an invitation to the Foreign Service Oral Assessment, you also receive an invitation to an overview of that assessment. It's about 2.5 hours long. It gives you structure. It gives you information about the structure of the day, what's going to be evaluated, et cetera.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Hey, I appreciate
sure,
it.
Thank you,
everybody.
Andrew, ask your question and unmute yourself.
Hello. So my question is a little different from the normal range of questions here. So my questions are is mainly about the leisure amenities that are offered at embassies. So I'm familiar with the embassy in Kabul and Baghdad, just working there as a defense contractor. And I know that they, or from what I've heard, that there are quite a few leisure amenities located at, like, within those embassy compounds and whatnot. I'm sure most embassies in more, you know, safe locations, quite frankly, are quite different, but does your typical embassy have things located at the embassy itself, such as maybe a gym or a library or things of that nature? Does it vary widely as every embassy and consulate is different?
Varies widely. If you're, you know, Kabul is a place where, places where you're living in a dangerous environment, they try to do more things. It also depends on the embassy being fairly large. We had a very small embassy in Algeria in a critical threat post, and we didn't have many amenities at all. I would not count on amenities. You may have them in some places. Also, if you're in a place where you have military bases, you may have access there. But by and large, you will be well cared for by the GSO section. You're not quite living on the community. But neither are you living in a gated community necessarily in most places.
I would like to slightly disagree. I mean, I agree with Ron and, the really big embassies. I'm a gym rat, so I can really, really answer the gym thing extremely well. Even after the Foreign Service, the first thing I do when I was running an NGO is I'd go see the ambassador and ask if I could use the gym. So I know a lot about gyms all over the world. And we had a great gym in Athens. We had a great gym in Bosnia. I kind of pushed for both of them and we got them. Ron's right. I mean, the higher threat post, it's more difficult to get out and you'll have more amenities in the Kabuls. Well, you don't have anything in Kabul now, but you did Kabul and Baghdad and places like that. When you're in a Western European post, you'll probably have very little because you don't need it. It's all in the local community. There are some places where we have a large military presence or even a smaller one where we have a commissary and you can get things that you might not be able to get in the local markets and all. So it does depend. But I think there's a much greater sensitivity toward your question than I would say there would have been 25 years ago. There's a realization that, whether it's, libraries is something a little bit different, and I'm not an expert on that, in many places around the world, the best libraries are outside of the embassy. But We also have something that we haven't talked about at all. In most embassies, we have a community liaison office. Jason, is it still called, and Yolanda, is it still called CLO? Okay, and that's a person who's hired to worry about the needs of the community. And that's a very, very important job. And my wife was the CLO in, she worked with the CLO in a bunch of places. And that's a very key job. And we put a lot of resources into that. So Andrew, in a word, I think you would not be disappointed wherever you go. You might not get, you know, it depends on what your standards are, you know. So I'll leave it at that.
Thank you, Andrew. There have been a couple of questions about age. So you have to be, to join the Foreign Service, you must be between 21 and 60 by the time that you swear in. The last information that Jason and I received about the mean age of Foreign Service officers was 34, which means, if you do the math, it means that there have to be people who are at the lower end of that spectrum of 21, and also people at the upper end. My A100 class, A100 is our orientation class, boot camp for diplomats, if you will. There were people in that class all over that age spectrum. We had two who were 21, and I find them amazing because when I was 21, I was not nearly focused enough to be in the Foreign Service. And we also had a couple of people who were 59, and they knew coming in that they were going to do about 5 years of service because our mandatory retirement age is 65. So 21 to 60. Alana, ask your question, unmute yourself.
Hi, I apologize. I can't turn on my camera, otherwise my laptop will crash. But I was wondering, I have a five-year-old son, and I was wondering how much, whether I can request to go to a dangerous area or not, because I have a family, or if that's something that you just have to deal with. Thank you.
Really quickly, so we are fortunate in that we have never directed anyone to a post that is unaccompanied. So I'm assuming your question about your family is whether or not you can take your family with you. So unlike some other agencies, we put out the call for people to serve in places that are unaccompanied. And to date, we've never had to direct anyone to go there. We've always been able to get people to go to those places, which sort of speaks to the Foreign Service. Somebody's dream post is somebody else's nightmare post. And so it's just sort of worked out for us in that way. When it comes to posts that are unaccompanied, a post may start out accompanied and then become unaccompanied. So those are things that all have to be put into play when you start to think about where you want to bid, where it is that you want to work. And things fall apart sometimes. My last post, which is how every great Foreign Service story starts, in my last post, Kinshasa, my husband was in Mali, which is unaccompanied. I was in Kinshasa with our son. Kinshasa was evacuated 3 times in 3 years for civil unrest. I could not send our son to Mali because that was unaccompanied to be with his dad. His dad could not come into Kinshasa to get him because we were unaccompanied. So Americans could not come in. Americans under Chief of Mission Authority could not come in. My mother came to Kinshasa to evacuate our son twice, not once, but twice. So these things do happen. It does mean, I think Ambassador Miller said this early on, you really need to have a discussion with your significant others. You need to be talking with your family. This is a job and a lifestyle. That said, you bid on these jobs knowing that that may happen. I mean, anyone who looked at the history of Kinshasa could not have been surprised about what the elections might look like. We knew that going into that situation. So all that to say, you definitely have say about where your family goes because you know what the staffing pattern of that post is going to be like before you bid it.
Can I just add something, Yolanda?
Please, please.
If I may. There, I've seen in the chat box a bunch of questions about spouses and families and all. And I will say the Foreign Service is a lot more sensitive now to family needs than it was when Ron and I first started. Family then was kind of excess baggage. There is another podcast, which maybe Yolanda, you can type this in, that I'd like to call to your attention. It's interviews with spouses, ranging from pretty new to, spouses who've been around forever. I think the age range is in the mid 30s to 85. And it's done by the American Diplomatic Studies Training, ADST. And I would strongly recommend the podcast. They're not quite ready. They'll be ready, I think, near around the first of the year or a little after that. But the website is adst.org. And then you click on podcast. And then you click further on Partners in Diplomacy. And that will give you a really good range of the experience of spouses. And when I say spouses, I mean that in a broader sense, gay couples, what have you. And I think they can describe what it's been like job-wise, family-wise, much better than any of us can in a very limited time here. So again, it's adst.org, click on podcast, and then click on Partners in Diplomacy.
Thank you for that. And that is in the chat. Let's go to Andrew and Tiffany, and then Guy, if we have time, we'll come back to you. Andrew, unmute yourself.
Yes, thank you also for this very informative session. What really grasped my attention was the earlier scenarios where it is sometimes in the duty of a officer to sort of be proactive and not necessarily always respond to assignments from Washington. But if there is something locally speaking that would somehow kind of engage your attention, that would kind of lead to a human rights discussion or some sort of security nuance, then it has to be addressed. What about scenarios where information is blurry or obscured for security reasons or intelligence reasons, right? There's some evidence that the Ukrainians are selling weapons to Nigerian terrorists. So let's say, for example, if you are sent to Ukraine or Nigeria, and there are possibilities of you obtaining some sort of local information that such and such is the case, and how do you proceed from there? How would you have the certainty that the information that you acquire is sufficient, that is clear, that is reasonable or persuasive? Local corruption is a huge problem, even in the United States, let alone in other countries. There's no reason to believe that somebody was bribed and then eventually were misled. So how do you kind of work with these sorts of nuances that are intelligence bent? And how can you be sure that you are actually offering a significant contribution, not misleading resources or bureaucracy?
Ambassadors, I'll give you an opportunity to respond to that in this unclassified form.
Well I would say, look, very rarely is intelligence clear-cut, is the kind of information, Andrew, that you're talking about, clear-cut. There's always nuances, there's always uncertainties. And if you are looking for Ukrainians supplying arms to Nigerians or whatever, or you know, what's going on the Ukrainian-Russian border with weapons, et cetera, my recommendation, and I realize we're in an unclassified forum, is to work with your colleagues from the intelligence community who are also tasked with this assignment as well. This would be a high priority for them. And one of the secrets that we don't talk about much, but one of the very important relationships is as a political officer in the embassy, is to work very closely with with our intelligence community overseas to try to get at some of these ambiguities. And the reality is, Andrew, a lot of this stuff, you're never going to get good enough information to confirm it, to corroborate it, and you're going to be dealing with ambiguities.
Pastor Newman?
Tom's covered the main point. You're going to have other people, I guess, there will be other people at post, whether it is the intelligence, whether it's political military section, and above you, the ambassador, DCM, others, with whom you can confer and decide what the appropriate approach is, whether the information is being taken seriously enough, and how you check it out, and or whether you should be the one to check it out, or whether it's something you're passing on to somebody else to check out. And after that, there are so many potential scenarios that I don't think one can sketch out all these things, except to point out that you have other people to consult with. You're not going to be alone in making these decisions, but neither should you necessarily give up the question without thinking that you have an adequate answer.
Yolanda, if I could just add one other thing. every ambassador carries a letter from the president. And this letter gives the ambassador the authority over not just the State Department people at post, but all other people at the embassy, except for the combatant commands. That's a separate chain of command. And, you know, the successful ambassador never has to even mention this letter. Everyone knows they've got it. And this is a perfect example where, you know, ideally the political officer will work with his colleagues in the intelligence community to answer this question. The ambassador doesn't have to get involved other than to say, great result, way to go. But if the situation arises, everyone at post knows the ambassador has that letter of authority from the president. And that's the ambassador's job, if it's necessary, to make sure that the different agencies at post are working together.
You know, we're 18 months into Zooming, and sometimes we're still on mute. We are a little over time, but there are a couple of questions that are burning, and I want to make sure that folks that have their hands up have a chance to get their questions asked. The first is about naturalized citizens. So an American citizen is an American citizen, whether you became an American yesterday or whether you were born an American. So every clearance process is its own process. There are no preclusions necessarily about holding citizenship or dual citizenship with another country. So in your process of your clearances, this is after you've passed the Foreign Service oral assessment, every candidate must be able to secure a top secret security clearance and a worldwide availability medical clearance. Those two things are required for the job. So it really depends on what your links are in your home country. Is your uncle the prime minister? That may be complicated. So every single candidate has an individual clearance process. So there are not blanket preclusions. So there were several questions about that. Tiffany and then Mara Tavia. And then we're going to end with, looks like Lone, John, and Guy, because we are over time. So Tiffany, unmute yourself.
Thank you so much. And thank you so much for this information. It's been very, very helpful. I actually had questions more about personal security as a female who is interested in going to unaccompanied countries that may be experiencing hardship. I just wanted to know, like, as I'm preparing to take the exam, do you recommend that I take a self-defense class as a part of my preparation during the process? Or is that a part of, I believe you referred to it as 101, the boot camp? I didn't know if maybe some basic level self-defense was offered. I'm sure, like, while I'm at the embassy, there's security. I think I'm just more like when I'm leaving the embassy and I'm going to my private residence, wanting to feel secure if it's just me by myself.
Sure, you can absolutely take self-defense classes if you want, but there's something that we all go through. It's called FAST. Jason and I are probably of the generation that call it crash and bang, which is your personal security and your security course. As a matter of fact, I believe it was CBS that profiled that training. I'll find the link and put it in the chat. So you will have the opportunity, as a matter of fact, you'll be required to take this training before you go overseas so that you can help protect yourself. Martavia. Sure.
Hi, thank you everyone. And again, just to thank you, Mr. Newman, Mr. Miller, and yourself, Yolanda and Jason. My question is regarding the language, and I apologize, I'm not on video, I'm having some difficulty as well. I've been looking at this for the last 3 to 5 years. I'm currently a civil servant with a contracting officer with the Army, and been looking at wanting to make that transition when I hit my 10-year mark, but I've been very leery because of the language. So I've studied Russian in the past, wasn't sure if I need to gear up that because if that was something the FSO or the DOS might need. So I was wanting to know if there was any languages that in particular the State Department is singling out to say, hey, we're really encouraging people to go this direction with this language, or there's a need for this language or to see more people in this language.
Jason, why don't you tell them all that they ever wanted to know about Consular Fellows?
Consular Fellows is a specific program for people with certain language skills, Arabic, Chinese, Portuguese, or Spanish, where you can do up to 5 years of work basically very similar to that you do as a entry-level consular officer. So visa interviews and helping American citizens overseas. So that's the only foreign service opportunity that requires a language. As Yolanda had mentioned earlier, to become a foreign service officer or a foreign service specialist, languages are not required. However, she also indicated at the oral assessment phase, you can get extra points based on certain languages. And certain languages, you don't have to score as high of level as others. So that will give you some idea which languages, you know, are of high demand.
A list to all of that are in the link. You can find those in the State MAG and the Foreign Service Employee link. I'll put it back in there again. And this is also on careers.state.gov. Loan, John, and Guy, and then I'm going to let Ambassador Newman have the last word. Loan.
Oh, hello.
Hi.
Sorry, I have my, hi. So I have a question. It's just a question out of curiosity. You said that 24-hour news and the internet has made it easier for foreign service officers. Can you let me know how that's been easier and how that has changed the system at all?
I think he said it was easier and harder. Am I misquoting you, Ambassador Newman? Or Ambassador Miller?
I think it's harder. You know, I think it's much harder because
there's one question. There's a lot of information.
Go ahead, Ron.
No, I think you are competing to some extent with the news media. I think that's where Tom was going. That makes it harder. People in Washington will know about an event before you have a chance to tell them about it. Often they may know it wrongly. They may not know what's important about it. So it is, in a way, you're competitive. Your job, though, why they should care and what the situation actually is, that's more important than ever. But it's changed because of the internet. Internet also puts pressures on you because everybody in Washington has an interest, will ask you separately to be telling them, giving them their own answers about things. So it just changes the job, but it still remains incredibly difficult.
I would agree as a public affairs officer, I would agree. Having that information out before you know you can figure out exactly what that means is challenging. So embassy has tires burning out front. What does that mean exactly? It's not that the report is incorrect. It's just the so what. What exactly does that mean? And that's the value added to that we bring to that kind of reporting. I hope that answers your question, Lon. John, your question? And then Guy.
Great. Yeah. Okay. Thought I was cutting out there. I just want to thank all the panelists for coming out tonight. My question revolves around the political career track and being a political officer. When you're a political officer and you're in a critical threat country, such as you know places in the Middle East or maybe Africa or other you know dangerous places around the world, how does that change your job? You know, as I mentioned before, when you're going out to meet contacts in the government and have these you know sorts of discussions, it could be you know pretty dangerous in you know countries like the Middle East and other places. So, you know, how does it change? How does the job responsibilities change and the way you go about things differ from, you know, region to region? And, you know, how do you kind of go about that?
I think, Yolanda, if it's okay, I'm going to toss this one to Ron because we've been at the Academy, been working on exactly this issue. So, Ron, over to you. Ron, you there?
He was.
Okay, well, I'll answer it in his absence because I've been part of this group. You know, it's gotten to the point, particularly post-Benghazi, where it's become more and more difficult for officers to get out and do their jobs in high threat posts. And it's gotten to the point where a bunch of us, led by Ron and a few other colleagues, have gone to the Congress and said, you got to kind of lighten up on what we call the accountability review boards. Accountability review boards were something that was passed. It was a law that was passed in the mid 80s that mandate that accountability review board be formed anytime there's significant damage or casualties at an embassy overseas. And everyone's, you know, it's gotten to the point where, you're afraid of going out lest or subjecting yourself to, to danger to do your job. And it's gotten to the point after Benghazi that, we have posts where people don't leave the compound, like in Kabul, for instance, Baghdad a little bit less. And I think it's gone overboard too much. And we're trying to get that, the law basically changed that will allow people to do their jobs. The bottom line, John, is that it's a dangerous profession. You know, I've had two very close friends killed by terrorism, and all of us can tell stories. It's not suicidal, but it is dangerous, and you have to recognize this. And we do work under, in many places under threatening conditions. One little factoid that most people don't know is there have been more ambassadors killed in line of duty than generals. And that's part of the job, of the career. Ron, while you were gone, the question was, I think you heard the question, but I started talking about the accountability review boards, and I probably didn't cover it as adequately as you could. But, you know, we all recognize it's just the pendulum swung too far, and we have to be able to do our jobs. We can't be in walled compounds and be expected to do the job of a political officer. Ron, do you want to add anything?
Oh, absolutely. I'm sorry. The internet gods seem to have kicked me off temporarily, but at least they let me back. And it doesn't mean that you're a soldier or Marine, but there are risks, and they come and go with different posts. And I've served in three critical threat posts. And that's something that comes with the terrain, and a place that isn't dangerous can become dangerous. Europe has had terrorist incidents. So if you want to have a risk-free job, don't join the Foreign Service. On the other hand, it doesn't mean that you're taking wild risks or, being a cowboy, but there's a lot of ways to mitigate risk, but there is risk that comes with a job.
We are so in agreement. This is something that public affairs officers have been talking about. Not one of us has been able to figure out how to do good public diplomacy from our desk. So that is a broader discussion. So before we go to Guy's question, which will be the last, I see there's lots of chatter back and forth about renouncing citizenship and et cetera, et cetera. So two things. First of all, anecdotes are not data necessarily. Everyone's security clearance is going to be its own process. So it greatly depends on what your ties are to that country. Again, if your uncle is the prime minister, that might be quite complicated for your security clearance, but there are no baseline preclusions. If you have a citizenship, there are lots and lots of diplomats who have dual citizenship. Some have three nationalities in some cases. I know one person who has three nationalities, and they are in the Foreign Service serving the United States and serving this country. So that process is going to be its own process as part of your security clearance. And Guy, you have the last question. Ambassador Newman will have the last word.
Thank you very much. This is a question primarily for Mr. Vordenstrass, but anyone else, please, by all means, jump in. You mentioned that part of your job is not only writing reports for the United States, but also occasionally for the host countries, and you use the example of Tijuana and human trafficking. Like, to what degree do you have to tailor these reports for host countries, particularly when some of the governments are highly corrupt and some of the people in the governments may be involved in the very acts and human trafficking or drug trafficking that you're trying to tamp down on?
Sure. So just to clarify, if I said that, I didn't mean to. What I was saying is that the reports you're writing are for the U.S. government consumption, usually for the U.S. Department of State. Occasionally, you might be asked to give input for some other agency's reports. If there are, like, for example, the Department of Labor does worst forms of child labor report that I have contributed to on several occasions. But you're not writing reports for the host government. You are, though, if you're at a consulate, you're coordinating your input to those reports with the embassy, because the embassy, you know, is basically the lead over, you know, the reporting that's coming out of that country. So in Mexico, there were 9 consulates. So on occasion, I would coordinate things with other consulates because I covered 2 Mexican states, and some other times, you know, some of the things that I was covering, especially if it was related to human trafficking, maybe there were human trafficking networks that crossed state borders or consular district borders. So sometimes I would have to talk to my colleagues at other consulates. Yeah. So it's not so much a matter of you know, the host government receiving our reports. It's just a matter of working with other colleagues, you know, across the mission, all the different posts in the country, to make sure that you're getting the most accurate information back to Washington, D.C.
Okay, thank you.
You did touch on an interesting point, which is anything you do in the public domain is going to have multiple audiences. And so in some cases, if you write a report honestly, you will tick off your host government. They can be really mad. Now, ultimately, it's the ambassador who's going to have to absorb the anger. So they're going to have to decide just how forthright to be and how to shape it. And, you know, that just comes with a turf. But you don't have the luxury of speaking only to one audience when you speak in public. That's certainly true of public diplomacy officers. It's true of anything that where you have to talk about policy.
Absolutely. We have gone over time this evening. I want to thank the panelists for giving us extra time. This was a larger audience than we've had. So thank you for your indulgence as we've gone over time this evening. For all of the candidates, I really urge you to reach out to your diplomat in residence. If I'm not your diplomat in residence, or Jason, our 14 other colleagues are happy to talk with you and to talk you through this process. And my thanks, Ambassador Newman, Ambassador Miller, thank you. And for all of you who are here, you've read their bios. It's just so kind of them to give back to you. They're thinking about you as you're going on this process. So we greatly, greatly, greatly appreciate it. Ambassador Newman.
I will just say that this is a fascinating, challenging, difficult career. It has to be, you know, it has downsides. It has to be what you want. But it is a career that counts. And I think, I'm pretty sure I speak for Tom as well, saying if you want a career where you feel that you are engaged in important issues, you know, this is definitely it. If you wanted to make policy the first day you joined the Foreign Service, it might not be the right career. It's a long apprenticeship, which is actually kind of sensible because frankly, you don't know enough to be at the top when you join the career. That's a hard old guy statement, but I think it's true. It's a complicated business, but it is incredibly rewarding. The people you work with are as intellectually fascinating and interesting as I believe any profession in the world, but you do need to look at the downsides as well and do a gut check and decide, is this really what you want to do? And Yolanda, thank you for giving us this opportunity to talk. And Tom, thank you so much for being part of the discussion. Jason, thank you for being with us.
Thanks, everyone. Again, at the end of this series, we have 2 left. On Wednesday night, we're going to be talking all things management. And then on Saturday, the 11th of December, we'll end with our consular colleagues. At the end of this series, we'll have all 5 videos, and they will reside on the Academy's website. Thanks so much, and have a good night.